Hi everyone, Jeff Samaha. Hope you've been enjoying an evening of theater at home these past few weeks. Tonight, our feature presentation, we bring you a show we are very proud of, Annie the Musical. I asked our longtime choreographer, director, and friend, Kathy Valentine, to take on the show, especially because of her expertise with kids. And as usual, she has come through once again. Also, I decided to step aside as musical director and conductor and asked our accompanist and co-musical director, Annie Rebold, to take over the conducting chore while I take a break. A back seat. Well, not a back seat. Not totally. Well, you'll see what I mean. Along with producer Karen Tadros, Kathy Valentine, and Annie Rebold, they coerced me into playing a role in the show. I spoke with them earlier today and discussed some interesting aspects of this production. Welcome, everyone. Karen, I'd like to begin with you. How did pulling this show together differ at all from other shows you have produced with us?
So we were at a new venue. We were at All Lady of Angels for this show. So getting to know a new space is always a challenge. Where are the lights? How do you lock the doors? Who has the key? Who doesn't have the key? And this was no different. It was a lovely space to work in because it was small and it was intimate and the audience was really very close to the action. But our cars got locked in the parking lot one night. We ended up having to, well, not me, my husband ended up having to drive our lighting guy all the way out to Jersey at 1 o'clock in the morning and then go pick him up the next day and bring him back. Thankfully, after that, they gave us the keys to the parking lot. But you know, it's a great space, but, you know, my preference, as you know, Jeff, is to always find a venue that's fully loaded, like a car, lights and sounds included. And this was not that, so we had to bring all of that in and get it all set up. And, you know, that reduces your tech time, but it was a great space. And we had a great set that was built by Carl Talent, which really pulled the whole stage together. His set really fit beautifully. And the way Kathy moved it and made it work with all the scene work that was going on. It was a great space. No wings, of course, but great space.
We never have wings.
When no, we don't. Have wings? Because they don't ask us to build the theaters.
Annie, talk about your experience working with this great group of adults and young kids and how you accomplished teaching everyone on different schedules.
Sure. First of all, the whole cast was an absolute joy to work with, and I mean that. I'm not just saying this. The children were incredible, worked very hard, loved each other, supported each other. And we had to have separate schedules, like you said, due to them having to go to school early in the morning. So we would teach the children their songs, their harmonies, at earlier times and have the adults come in on other nights. And there were many songs with the choral arrangements where we had to combine and integrate the children with the adults, which worked out beautifully because the children really did their homework. They did their music homework and I think they kept up with their academic as well. They were a joy to work with. They learned their harmonies. They had the verb, the personalities came through, and it was a joy to work with. It's always something you anticipate or you think you're going to have difficulty possibly with separate rehearsals due to children and adults. This was just remarkably smooth, and it was such teamwork with everybody supporting the others. It was a family on top of a musical project. So
it's amazing how sometimes kids learn quicker than the adults.
Oh, they did. They knew they did. They knew their songs. They knew their lyrics. They were articulate. Their harmonies they maintained.
Yeah, I can vouch for the learning process. Mm-hmm. Kathy, can you describe your experience directing and choreographing Annie the Musical? After all, that was a lot of responsibility to take on.
Well, yes. Doing a show like Annie is always fun. It's always something that, well, it could go either way, but we were very lucky. Because I always find that one of my favorite things to do when doing a show is from the casting standpoint. Those few days are torturous to all the actors, but I find them to be the most rewarding, because I think from the beginning, you have to find all of the right puzzle pieces that eventually will put together a beautiful puzzle and complete the puzzle. And we were very lucky. We had wonderful, talented children and adults that came down, and they fit together perfectly. So teaching them everything, doing the directing and the choreography, was simple because everybody was such a joy to work with. From the kids to the adults to the parents. The parents of these children were amazing. They brought so much to our production. And as Annie said, we weren't just a cast, we were a family, and we still are. These kids still talk to each other. We get together. It grew from strangers in an audition room to a family at the end. And that was, I believe, also due to the fact that we were all such a great team and worked seamlessly together to accomplish one goal. And it was still, to this day, my most memorable and joyful theater experiences that I've ever worked on.
Thanks, everybody. I'm sure there are many more stories you could speak about.
Sure.
Sure are. But we won't tell those.
I have come to appreciate our actors and what it takes to become familiar with a script. In my case, only a few pages, and to perform facing the audience for a change. Well, you'll see how that went. Also, I might add, we decided to put up two versions of Annie since we had double cast the role of Annie and some others. So now it gives me great pleasure to bring to you Annie the Musical as our featured archived video presentation on an evening of theater at home. Choose the version you'd like to watch, Saturday at 2 p.m. or Saturday at 8 p.m. Both are marked in the title on YouTube. Enjoy the show.
Thank you. was only a dream, honey. Now you gotta go back to sleep. It's after 3 o'clock.
Annie, leave me alone.
My note? Again, please.
Here it comes again.
Please take good care of our little darling. Her name is Annie.
She was born on October 28th. We'll be back together here soon.
We have left half the silver locket around her neck and kept the other half so that when
One for you, one for you, one for you, and one for you. Aggie, I'm running a little late. I will see you in January.
Oh, come here, you big handsome brute. Don't you want to know what I'm getting you for Christmas?
What?
Egg Foo Young in Chinatown for two on me.
Egg Foo Young for Christmas.
All you can eat. So, what are you getting for me?
What did I get you last year?
Nothing.
Good, you get it again.
Get out of here with that damn laundry.
Okay, Merry Christmas, Aggie. Merry Christmas, kids.
When I'm stuck with the day, that's gray and lonely.
pretty yet.
Patience, patience.
Make way for John D. Rockefeller.
Yeah, go today now.
7 million people in the city, and you can't sell one last yet.
Excuse me. Did anybody here leave a redheaded kid at an orphanage 11 years ago?
Not today, kid. Not today.
Ladies and gents, dinner is served. Soup is on.
Hey, kid, you hungry?
No.
Okay.
But my dog is.
Here, kid. Here, kid. Eat your fill.
Thanks, lady.
Say, kid, what brings you out here alone this time of night?
I'm looking for my mom and dad. They're lost.
Lost? How long you been looking for him?
11 years.
Now that's lost.
Say, kid, it's time to give up.
No! I am going to find them.
Now there's something I haven't heard since 1928.
What?
Optimism.
Optimism. What do we gotta be optimistic about? Look at us. Life's a nightmare.
Well, you've gotta have a dream.
Traveling overhead all night.
To wake you up from your nightmare.
Empty pockets.
At least you got pockets.
Freezing fingers.
Lucky you got them. Empty pockets.
Newspapers for blankets.
You can read in bed.
Kid, you should have been a politician.
Yeah, you should have run against Roosevelt.
Hey, listen to this. In an interview today, former President Herbert Hoover said, "Although I am in no way responsible for the 1929 stock market crash."
Yes.
I have the deepest sympathy for those who are left ragged, hungry, and homeless.
Ragged?
Hungry! Homeless! Today we're living in a shanty. Today we're scrounging for a meal.
Today I'm stealing coal for fires. Who knew I could steal?
I used to winter in the tropics. I spent my summers at the shore. I used to throw away the papers. We don't anymore. We'd like to thank you, Herbert Hoover, for really showing us the way. We'd like to thank you, Herbert Hoover. You made us what we are today. Prosperity was round the corner. Cozy cottage built for two. And it's the rabbit that you gave us. Yes, we're turning blue.
They offered us Al Smith and Hoover.
We paid attention and we chose. Not only did we pay attention, we paid through. Don't we have the chicken? We ain't got the pot. Hey, Herbie, you left behind a grateful nation. So Herbie, hats are off to you. We're up to here with admiration.
Come down and have a little stew.
Come down and share some Christmas dinner. Be sure to bring the missus too. We got no turkey for our stuffing. Why don't we stuff you? We'd like to thank the Herbert Hoover for really showing us the way. You dirty rat, you're a brat, you made us what we are today. Come and get it, Herb.
Let's go.
the month.
Down by the docks. Had a maid him up with her, but he got away.
Oh, poor little pumpkin, out there in the freezing cold with just that thin little sweater. I hope he didn't catch influenza. Thank you so much, officer.
All in the line of duty. And you, don't ever let me hear that you ran away from this nice lady.
She is not.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, officer. Now, I'm gonna have your head. And the next time you walk out of here, it'll be 1953. Well, you glad to be back?
Yes, Miss Hannigan.
Liar! What is the one thing I always taught you? Never tell a lie. Well, what is the one thing I always taught you?
Never tell a lie, Miss Hannigan.
For what you've done, I could be fired. Have the Board of Orphans sticking their nose in here. You're gonna pay for this, I promise. Stay.
Good afternoon, Miss Hannigan?
Yeah.
Good. I'm Grace Farrell.
So?
And the New York Board of Orphans suggested that I
come in. Oh, wait a minute. Hold it. I can explain everything. It wasn't my fault. You see, it was Annie. She got into Mr. Bundle's laundry, but I had
no... Oh, Miss
Hannigan. And I know. I should have called Mr. Donatelli, not the cops.
Oh, Miss Hannigan, I haven't the slightest idea what you're talking about.
Oh, wait a minute. Hold it, sister. If it's beauty products you're peddling, I don't need any. Get out.
I am not peddling anything. Miss Hannigan, I am the private secretary to Oliver Warbucks.
Oliver Warbucks? The Oliver Warbucks?
The Oliver Warbucks.
I love your hat! I read in Winchell's column that Mr. Warbucks is the world's richest unmarried man.
I wouldn't know anything about that. I don't read Mr. Winchell. Mr. Warbucks has decided to invite an orphan to spend the Christmas holidays at his home.
An orphan?
Yes, an orphan.
Are you sure he wouldn't rather have a lady? I got 2 weeks coming. It's a joke. What sort of orphan did he have in mind?
Well, she should be friendly and intelligent.
Mississippi, capital MISSISSIPPI, Mississippi.
And cheerful.
Shut up! And how old?
Oh, age doesn't really matter. Say 8 or 9. 10? 11? 11. 11 would be perfect. Oh, and I almost forgot. Mr. Warbucks prefers redheaded children.
11. A redhead?
Yes.
Nope, I'm afraid we don't have any orphans like that around here.
Oh, well, what about this child right here?
Oh, Annie? You don't want Annie. She's a drunk. And a liar. She's a drunken liar.
Yes, I'm sure she's a drunk and a liar. Annie, come here. How would you like to spend the next 2 weeks at Mr. Warbucks' house?
I would love to. I would really love to.
Ah, hold it. You can have any orphan in this orphanage, not Annie.
Well, why?
I just told you.
I assume, Miss Hannigan, that this has something to do with the laundry and the police. I could call Mr. Donatelli down at the Board of Orphans. Sign it.
I'll sign it. I'm an easy gal to get along with. If it's Annie you want, it's Annie you'll get.
It's Annie I want.
It's Annie you'll get.
Oh, boy!
Now, if you'll just get her things and her coat, I will take her along right now.
Coat? She don't have no coat.
How close this was.
Well then, we'll buy her one.
Oh boy!
We'll take her down to Bergdorf's and get you a warm winter coat.
I'm getting a coat!
She's getting a coat!
Well, come along, dear. Mr. Warbucks' limousine is waiting.
Boy, I can hardly believe it.
She can hardly believe it?
Hey, kids, I'm getting out for Christmas. All right, see ya.
Bye, Annie.
Bye, kids.
Bye, Annie.
Good afternoon, Miss Hannigan. And season's greetings.
Yeah, season's greetings.
good afternoon, Miss Farrow.
Good afternoon, Drake, everyone.
Miss?
Has Mr. Warbucks arrived?
Not yet, Miss. His plane from Chicago landed at 3:30. We are expecting him any minute.
Do you really live here? Or is this the train station?
We really live here.
Oh, boy!
Mrs. Greer?
Yes, Miss?
Has the carpet been put down in the dining room, Mrs. Greer?
Yes, Miss.
And has the Steinway been too?
Yes, Miss.
Everything is in order, Miss. Mrs. Pugh has prepared his favorite dinner.
New England clam chowder.
Wonderful.
Kentucky fried chicken.
Wonderful.
Idaho potatoes.
And?
Baked Alaska.
Fine.
It would be good for you to see Mr. Warbucks again.
Yes. 6 weeks is a long time.
Yes.
Now, if I could have everyone's attention, please.
Quickly, everyone. Everyone, quickly.
Everyone, this is Annie. She will be spending the next 2 weeks with us for the Christmas holiday.
Miss
Annie, this is everyone.
Hi, everybody.
May I take your coat, Miss?
Will I get it back?
Oh, of course, dear. I'm so glad, dear. Now, Annie, what would you like to do first?
The floors. I'll scrub them, and then I'll get to the windows.
No, Annie,
and then...
Annie, you won't have to do any cleaning while you're here.
I won't?
Of course not. You are our guest, and for the next 2 weeks, you're going to have a swell time. Cecile will pick out all your clothes.
Green!
Don't lose your color, I think. Your bath is drawn by Mrs. Green.
So, no bubbles, I think.
Annette comes in to make your bed.
The silk sheets, no satin, I think.
I think I'm gonna like it here.
The swimming pool is to the left. The tennis court is to the rear.
I've never even picked up a racket.
What? Have an instructor here at noon. Oh, get that Don Budge fellow if he's in it.
Yes, miss.
I think I'm gonna like it here.
When you wake, bring for drink. Drake will bring your tray.
Grace.
Yes, sir.
Messages.
Yes, sir. President
get back to him tomorrow morning. Anyone else?
John D. Rockefeller, Mahatma Gandhi, and Harpo Marx.
So nothing urgent. What did Harpo want?
He didn't say.
Wait a minute. Maybe I could learn to live with this thing. Hang it someplace.
Mr. Warburg.
Oh, and Mrs. Pugh.
New English lamb chow.
That's wonderful, Mrs. Pugh. But I won't be having dinner tonight. I have much too much paperwork to get through.
Wonderful!
And Grace, I'll need you for dictation.
Yes, sir.
All right, it's good to see you all. Drake, dismiss the staff.
Yes, sir.
Grace, if you'll get your notepad, we can... Who's that?
This is Annie, the orphan who will be spending the Christmas holidays with us.
The orphan? That is not a boy. Orphans are boys.
I'm sorry, sir. You just said orphan. So I chose a girl.
Well, I suppose she'll have to do. Annie, huh? Annie what?
Sure.
What's your last name, child?
Oh, I haven't got any last name that I know of.
So, you're just Annie, huh?
Just Annie. I'm sorry I'm not a boy.
Well, I don't suppose you'd want to meet Babe Ruth.
Oh, boy, sure!
Okay.
Who's Babe Ruth?
I couldn't be happier you'll be spending the holidays with us. Grace, we'll start with the iron ore shipments from Toledo to... Grace?
Yes, sir.
What are we supposed to do with this child?
It's her first night, sir.
First night? Annie, your first night. I suppose we ought to do something special for you. So, why don't you sit down?
Sir.
What is this? What is this? What are you doing? What is that? Movie? This is movie. So you want to go to a movie?
Oh boy, sure! I've heard a lot about them, but I've never been to one!
Never?
No, sir!
Well, then we'll have to do something about that right away. And nothing but the best for you, Annie. You'll go to the Roxy. And then, an ice cream soda. At Rumpelmeyer's. And then a hansom cab ride all around Central Park.
Golly!
Grace, forget about the dictation for tonight. We'll do it first thing in the morning.
Yes, sir.
Instead, you'll take Annie to the movies.
Oh. Yes, sir.
Oh, gee.
Something the matter, Annie?
Nothing, sir. It's just... Oh, gee.
Annie, what is it? Don't you want to go to the Roxy?
No, I want to. It's just that, well, I thought that you were going to take me.
Me? Oh, no. Annie, I'm far too busy to even consider. You see, Annie, I've just returned after having been away for 6 weeks, making an inspection tour of my factories, or what's left of my factories with this damn depression. And when a man is running a multi-billion dollar
business...
Excuse me, sir? Bernard Baruch calling.
Good. You talk to him. Yeah, hi, Barney. Yeah, about an hour ago. No, Detroit, Chicago. Look, Barney. I don't like what I saw out there. Factories shut down. My factories shut down. You're damn... Oh. No. Darn. You're darn. Toot. If I'm not making money, nobody is. And gosh darn it, Barney, your pal Roosevelt has got to come up with a new plan, a new attitude, a new something. Well, yes, yes, I know he's a Democrat, but he's a human being, too.
Oh!
Yes, Barney, come on over here tonight and we can discuss it all.
Oh!
Yeah, we'll go over all the figures.
Oh!
Barney, make that tomorrow night. Tonight, I have a date to go to the movies with a 10-year-old girl.
11!
Oh, my mistake. She's 11, Barney. Goodbye, Barney. Drake?
Yes, sir.
Coates?
Yes, sir.
You'll come too, Grace, of course.
Yes, sir.
Will you be wanting the Bentley or the Duesenberg, sir?
The Duesenberg.
Excellent choice, sir.
No, wait. This child's been cooped up in an orphanage. No Duesenberg. We'll walk.
Walk? To the Roxy?
Sure, why not? It's only 45 blocks.
Yes, sir.
Smell that. Marvelous. Fifth Avenue bus fumes. There's no air like the air in New York. And you don't realize how much you miss it. The whole damn city. Until you've been away from it for a while. It's like the man says, after New York, every place else is Bridgeport. NYC. What is it about you? You're big, you're loud, you're tough. NYC, I go years without you, then I can't get enough. Enough of cab drivers answering back in language far from pure. Enough of Frankfurters answering back. Oh, brother, you know you're in NYC. Too busy, too crazy, too hot, too cold, too late. I'm sold again on NYC. Come on, you slowpokes. We gotta get to the Roxy before the prices change.
Here all my life and never seen to stay.
Oh, NYC,
popcorn. What do you say to some popcorn? That's what that was.
Yes.
Oh, popcorn. Okay. Come here. Come here. Ugh. Give in. Don't fight. Good girl.
Sis,
Long time no see.
Rooster, God, it never rains, but it pours. They finally let you out of Sing Sing.
Yeah, they let me out 6 months early. Good behavior.
I'll bet. What was it this time?
Some geezer around in Yonkers said I swindled him out of $1,100.
Oh, yeah? Why did he say that?
Because the rooster swindled him out of $1,100. Oh, it's true.
Sis, I'd like you to meet a friend of mine from,
Jersey City.
Miss Lily St. Regis.
I'm named after the hotel.
Which floor?
Don't you just love Lily, sis?
Yeah, I'm nuts about her. Rooster, do me a favor.
Anything.
Get out of here and take the St. Regis with you.
Oh, come on, sis.
Pam, you looking for another handout, huh?
No. I got $80. Coming in the mail. Thursday. I could just use a 10 to tide me over.
Uh-uh, not even a nickel for the subway, Rooster.
A fiver, Aggie?
I gotta laugh. $5? Oh, God. You and your big talk. Gonna be living in Clover.
Now, what isn't exactly Buckingham Palace?
Yeah, I'm on the city. Steady salary, free food, free gas and electric. I'm doing all right.
Sis, you're doing like I'm doing.
Yeah. Lousy.
Ah, Aggie. How'd the two Hannigan kids end up like this? On the skids. I remember the way our sainted mother would sit and croon us her lullaby.
She'd say, kids, there's a place that's like no other. You gotta get there.
You don't get there by playing from the rule books.
No, you stack the aces.
You load the dice. Mother dear, oh, we know you're down there listening. How can we follow your sweet advice? Holds the key, this little lady,
to get more.
plumps
instead of less. Maybe we fix the game with something shady. One guess. Yes. Easy Street. Easy Street. Abby is stuck. Yes, sorry. Yes, sorry. Yes, sorry.
What they call Hell's Kitchen, right here in New York. Both my parents died before I was 10. And I made a promise to myself. Someday, one way or another, I was going to be rich. Very rich.
That was a good idea, sir.
And by the time I was 23, I had made my first million. Then, in 10 years, I turned that into 100 million. Boy, that was a lot of money in those days. Well, anyway, making money is all I've ever given a damn about. And I might as well tell you, Annie, I was ruthless to those that I had to climb over to get to the top. Because I've always believed one thing. You don't have to be nice to the people that you're climbing over to get to the top if you don't plan on coming back down again. But I've lately realized something. No matter how many Duesenbergs or Rembrandts you've got, if you have no one to share your life with, if you're alone, well, then you might as well be broken back in Hell's Kitchen. You understand what I'm trying to say, right?
Sure.
Good, good.
Kind of.
Kind of?
I guess not.
Oh, damn. Annie, I was in Tiffany's the other day, and I bought this thing for you.
Thank you, Mr. Warbucks. You're so nice to me.
I had it engraved. Annie, it's a silver locket. You see, I noticed that old broken one you always wear, and I said to myself, I'm going to get this kid a nice new locket.
Gee, thank you, Mr. Warbucks.
So why don't we just take this old one off and...
No! I don't want a new one!
Annie, what is it? What's wrong?
This locket... My mother and father left it with me when they left me at the orphanage. And there was a note, too. They love me, and they're coming back for me. And I know being here with you for Christmas, I'm real lucky. But the one thing I want in the world, more than anything else, is to be like other kids with books of my own.
Annie, it'll be all right, Annie. I'll find them for you, Annie. I'll find your mother and father.
It's okay. It's all right.
I'll go get her a brandy.
Are you all right, Annie? It'll be okay.
You'll see, Miss Annie. If anyone can find your parents, Warbucks is the man.
Mr. Warbucks will find your mother and father. If he has to pull every political string there is to pull, up to and including the White House.
The League of Nations.
If he should need the FBI.
J. Edgar, Warbucks, I want 50 of your best G-men. A day, a week, a month, however long it takes. We'll put them on vacation. I'll pay for it. I'll pay all costs. Fine. When can I have them? Well, tomorrow morning. Oh, and Jay, I want Elliot Ness. Well, take him off the Capone case!
Hip, hip!
I understand, Annie, but it could be our best clue. You see, the FBI will trace where it was bought, and then who bought it.
Okay. Well then, I think the FBI should have my note too.
You wait and see, Annie. You may be meeting your mother and father within a couple of days.
Really?
Really?
Oh boy, I gotta write a letter to the kids about this!
What a thing to occur, finding them, losing her. No, you won't be an orphan for long.
Mr. Warbucks says that I'll be meeting my mother and father within a couple of days. So maybe now it's time. And maybe when I wake, they'll be there calling me baby. Maybe.
Thank you. conducting a coast-to-coast nationwide search for any parents.
Yes, Murphy. I am now conducting a coast-to-coast nationwide search for Annie's parents.
Drop page. Furthermore, I am offering a certified check for $50,000 to any persons who can prove that they are Annie's parents.
Wow! So Annie's parents, if you're listening in, remember, write to Oliver Warbucks, care of this station, WEAF New York, or directly to him at
my home, Bertie.
Hi, Mr. Wheelie. Every time once again, for the lovely boy.
Yes. We knocked upstairs and no one answered. Are you the lady that runs this here orphanage?
Yeah.
Oh, Ralph, I'm scared. What if something happened to her?
Oh, Shirley, it's gonna be all right, Shirley. She's gonna be here and she's gonna be ours again. Miss.
What do you want?
Well, you see, we had terrible troubles back then, and we had to head up north. Had to leave a baby here on the front stoop.
Oh, our little girl. Our Annie.
Your Annie's parents?
Oh, please, nothing's happened to her. I don't believe it. Annie's parents. Where'd you say you come from again?
Oh, well, we come from a little farm up in Canada.
Manitoba.
We've got lots of chickens.
Oh, chicken.
Ducks. Geese.
Oh, you should see all them geese.
And a rooster.
She so wanted to meet you. I couldn't resist bringing her along, just to say hello.
Ah, the little girl who sang so beautifully on the radio last night.
Annie, this is President Roosevelt.
How do you do, President Roosevelt?
How do you do, Annie? You're as lovely as you sound on the radio.
Thank you, President Roosevelt.
Well, shall we begin?
Annie, if you'll wait for me outside.
No, let her stay. Having a child on hand will keep us on our best behavior.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Harold, I don't even want to hear a gosh out of you.
Franklin, a child?
Now, Oliver, since you speak so for so many wealthy Americans, I'd like to hear your thoughts on the matter.
Thank you, Mr. President. In the words of Calvin Coolidge,
the business of this country is business.
Yes! And for the good of all of us, this country, you and me, we've got to get my factories open and the workers back to work.
According to my latest figures, there are 15 million Americans out of work and nearly 50 million with no visible means of support.
Mr. President, if I may say so, unemployment is not our worst problem. The dispatches from Germany are becoming more and more disturbing each day. There could be war.
Germany, how people are starving in this country.
Harold, I know that, but in the long run, we're not...
Cordell, for those people who are starving, there is no long run.
The trouble is, it's happening all at once. The stock market has taken another nosedive.
Sit-down strikes, riots,
floods, dust storms.
And the FBI still hasn't caught Al Capone. Well, I think we're all agreed on one thing. The situation is hopeless and getting worse.
You know, I'd like to see those figures.
The sun will come out tomorrow. Bet your bottom dollar that tomorrow will be...
Quiet, girl!
Harold, that's okay, Annie. Go ahead. It's still a free country.
Just thinking about tomorrow clears away the cobwebs and the sorrow. Till there's none. When I'm stuck with the day, that's gray and lonely. I sink my chin and grin and say, the sun will come out tomorrow, so you gotta hang on till tomorrow. Come on then, tomorrow, tomorrow, I love ya, tomorrow, you're only a day away.
Harold Dickies, stand up.
What?
You heard me. Stand up, Harold, and sing.
Sing?
You heard me sing. Like Annie.
But
I've decided in my administration it's going to be anything. It's going to be optimistic about the future of this country. Now sing.
But Franklin, you know that I really can't.
Sing.
The sun will come out tomorrow. Bet your bottom dollar that tomorrow. There'll be sun.
Purpose.
Just thinking about tomorrow. Clears away the cobwebs and the sorrow. Till there's none.
Solo for the president. I think of a day that's gray and lonely. I stick out my chin and sing and say, everyone, Republicans too, all of us, sing.
The sun will come out tomorrow. So you gotta hang on till tomorrow. Come on then. Tomorrow, tomorrow, I love ya. Tomorrow, you're always a day away. Tomorrow, tomorrow, I love ya. Tomorrow, you're always a day away.
Ah, yes, excuse me, everyone. This isn't for me, it's for you, Oliver, from your secretary in New York. Hundreds of couples jamming street outside house, stop. All claiming to be Annie's parents, stop.
Oh, boy!
Have begun to scream them, stop. Suggest you return New York at once. Signed, Grace Farrell.
Well, Annie, it looks like the Hour of Smiles had a lot more listeners than we first thought, huh?
Gee! Hundreds of couples! One of them is bound to be my mother and father!
Well, Oliver, I suspect you ought to be returning to New York immediately.
If you don't mind, Mr. President.
Not at all.
Annie?
Bye, everybody!
Bye, Annie!
Goodbye, Mr. President.
Goodbye.
And thank you!
Oh, thank you. You're the kind of person the president should have around him.
Mr. President, why don't we set up 100, no, 1,000 federal projects?
Dams!
Yes!
Highways!
Yes!
New post offices!
Yes! And put the back to work!
Yes, and we could create 5 million new jobs within 6 months!
And weekly paychecks could help get those millions off of relief and back to paying taxes!
We'll build a country so strong that nobody, including Chancellor Hitler, could ever defeat us in a war.
Mr. President, what we've got to give this country is a new dedication.
A new outlook.
A new approach. A new concept.
A new outlook.
A new horizon.
A new attitude.
A new vision.
A new deal. Perkins, everyone. I was right the first time. The only thing we have to fear is fear itself. Tomorrow. I love you. Tomorrow. We're only a day away. Harmony.
Tomorrow. I love you. Tomorrow.
Mr. Warbucks, this just came by special messenger from the FBI.
Finally, thank you. Elliot Ness has located the manufacturer of Annie's locket in Utica, New York.
Oh, boy!
That sort of locket was manufactured between 1918 and 1924.
Sort of locket?
Over 90,000 were made and sold.
90,000?
Yes, Annie. I'm afraid the gist of it is that Elliot Ness doesn't think there's a chance in a million of finding your parents through the locket. I'm sorry.
It's okay. I mean, you did the best you could. Anyway, if you can't find them, nobody can. I mean, I guess a kid could learn to get along without folks. You didn't turn out so bad. You got everything. All them Duesenbergs hanging on the walls and everything.
Drake and I will check on dinner.
Annie, come here. Annie, a Duesenberg is a car. And Babe Ruth was the right fielder for the New York Yankees. And there's something else you should know. I've made me a fortune, that fortune made 10. Been headlined and profiled again and again. But something was missing, I never quite knew. That something was someone, but who? My speeches are greeted with thunderous acclaim at 2 universities bearing my name. Yet something was missing each time I got through. That something was someone, but who? Who could that someone be? How could she make it known? Who would need me for me? Need me for me alone? The world was my oyster, but where was the pearl? Who dreamed I would find it in one little girl? Yes, something was missing, but dreams can come true. That something is no one but you. Who would need me for me? Need me for me alone? The world was my oyster, but where was the pearl? Who dreamed I would find it in one little girl? Yes, something was missing, but dreams do come true. That something is no one but you. Grace.
Yes, sir.
Grace, do you have those legal papers I gave you the other day?
I'll get them right away, sir.
No, Grace, wait. I want you to stay for a moment. I haven't lost since J.P. Morgan went bust. Annie, I want to adopt you.
Adopt me?
Yes or no?
If I can't have my real mother and father, there's no one in the world I'd rather have for a father than you, Mr. Warbucks.
Drake!
Yes?
Call Judge Brandeis and tell him to come over here and sign those adoption papers.
Yes, sir.
And Grace.
Yes, sir.
Tell Mrs. Greer that we're going to have a house full of company. So So we're going to need flowers.
Flowers.
And champagne.
Champagne.
And caviar.
Caviar.
Yes.
Look. Oh. I'm fine.
Annie, this is not going to be just an adoption party. It's going to be a celebration. And you can have anyone in the world you want to come to it. So who would you like? John D. Rockefeller. No? Babe Ruth. Ooh, how about Madame Shanghai Check? She's a lot of fun.
Well, I guess I'd like Miss Farrell here, and Mr. Drake, and Miss Pugh, and Miss Greer, and Seal, and Nash, and, well, I guess I'd like everybody here.
That's Stein. That's exactly who I want here, too. Drake!
Yes, sir.
Tell the staff to get spiffed up. They're going to be the guests at Annie's adoption party.
Yes, sir.
Oh, and the kids!
Oh, no. It'll be way past their bedtime, Annie. But I'll tell you what. We can have everybody here tomorrow for a big Christmas party.
Miss Hannigan, too.
Sure, Miss Hannigan, too. Why not?
Excuse me, sir. Everyone is getting, and these are your words, sir, spiffed up for the party.
Great. So, you and I should get spiffed up, too. Grace!
Yes, sir.
Why the... That's a very pretty dress, Grace.
Thank you, sir.
Grace, have Annette put her in one of her new dresses and have Cecile do something with her hair, you know? Take her upstairs and... Oh, I don't know. Gussie her up.
Yes, sir. Gussie her up.
Annie. Everything's humming now. Yesterday is plain awful.
Then you can pick up Annie and the check.
Oh.
Is that a problem?
No, sir. Whatever you'd prefer. Well, I guess we better be getting back to our hotel then. Goodbye, Annie dear. Until tomorrow, where you'll be spending the rest of your life with us.
Oh, goodbye, Annie love.
Okay, yeah, goodbye, Annie. Merry Christmas. Oh, pardon me, Toots.
Oh, season's greetings.
Come on, yeah, season's greetings. Yes, come on. Go.
Well, Annie, this is wonderful news. Yes, Annie has found her mother and father, and they seem to be a very nice couple.
Yes, you're very lucky, Annie.
Right. You're lucky. Just think of pig farm.
Mrs. Greer.
Yes, sir.
Champagne.
Yes, sir.
We must celebrate. Because it's Christmas and Annie has found her mother and father. A toast to Annie. Mudge.
To Annie. Mudge. Annie! No, Annie!
Merry Christmas!
Merry Christmas.
It seems I have the same effect on everyone.
I've lost her. I've lost Annie.
Sir. That Mr. Mudge, I think I've seen him somewhere before. I can't remember where or when exactly, but I have the sneakiest suspicion that he is not who he says he is.
Mr. President.
Franklin,
I need your help.
Of course, Oliver. Whatever I can do for you.
Mr. and Miss Mudge!
No, Annie. They are not your parents. Your parents were David and Margaret Bennett.
David and Margaret Bennett? Where are they?
Annie,
your mother and father passed away a long time ago.
So you mean they're dead?
Yes, dear.
So I'm an orphan after all, like all the other kids.
Are you all right, Annie?
Yes. Because, well, I guess I always knew my folks were dead. Because I knew they loved me. And they would have come back for me if they weren't.
I love you, Annie Bennett.
And I love you too, sir. Now, who the heck are Ralph and Shirley?
Atta girl. Who the heck are Ralph and Shirley Mudge?
Well, the birth certificate could have been forged easily enough. But the thing is, they knew about the locket.
The locket, that's your key.
Yes, but the only ones who knew about the locket were us and the FBI.
And Miss Hannigan.
And Miss Hannigan!
And Miss Hannigan.
Miss Hannigan, sir, and the children from the orphanage.
Oh, send her in, Drake.
Yes, sir.
For Warbucks.
And you'll find this woman's their accomplice. Fa la 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 la. Arrest her too, please.
Hey, I've never seen these people before till yesterday.
Oh, come off it, Aggie.
Yes, Sister Bull and I are taking a fall, so are you.
Mr. Warbucks, Oliver, I ain't done nothing to you. I've always been some.
The jig is up.
Annie, Annie, tell them how nice and good I always was to you.
She... I'm sorry, Miss Hannigan, but remember the one thing you always taught me? Never tell a lie.
Brett! I'll let you in on a little secret. I never liked you, you gold digger. And I never liked any of you either.
You, your days are numbered.
Annie, we'd like to meet your friends.
Okay. Kids, this is Miss Farrell.
Hi.
Hi, kids.
And this is Mr. Daddy Warbucks.
Hi.
Hi, kids.
Oh, yeah, and this is President of the United States.
Hi.
Children.
Hi, kids.
Children, Miss Hannigan is gone. For good.
Yay!
And you won't have to work anymore.
Yay!
Instead, you'll have classrooms and teachers.
Yay!
Yeah! But listen, kids, no more mush!
No more mush! No more mush!
Yes, children, this is the beginning of a brand new life for all of us. I know the depression's depressing.
The cows are still, the stores are filled.
And windows are minus their dressing.
The children don't grin, the Santas are thin.
And I've heard a terrible rumor. No goodwill, no cheer. But we'll get a new deal for Christmas this year.
I'm falling in turkey.
We hope you enjoyed seeing Annie the Musical. Please look for our Facebook Live Wednesday evening when we announce the next Broadway production on An Evening of Theater at Home. I'm Jeff Samaha. Stay well. See you soon.